Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English. Coming up on the program, I report on research into growing crops on Mars. Dan Friedell and Gena Bennett have a story on the popularity of vinyl records in Brazil. Bryan Lynn has the science report on laser communication in space. Later, Jill Robbins and Andrew Smith present the lesson of the day. But first, for future humans to survive long periods on Mars, growing food on the planet is a must. It would be too costly and risky to rely on rocket deliveries to meet the food needs of colonists. With this in mind, scientists are exploring ways to improve space farming. At Wageningen University and Research in the Netherlands, researchers work in a controlled greenhouse. They have identified a way that could improve crop production in simulated Martian soil with different crops grown together. The method is called intercropping. It was first invented by ancient Maya farmers in what is now Central America. In their experiments, the researchers grew cherry tomatoes, peas, and carrots together in small round containers called pots. Tomatoes grown in this way produced about double the amount of tomatoes grown alone or monocropped in the same simulated Martian soil. The tomatoes were also bigger. They flowered and matured earlier, gave more fruit per plant, and had thicker stems. The amount of peas and carrots did not increase with intercropping. Rebecca Gonçalves is an astrobiologist and lead writer of the study published on Wednesday in the publication Plus One. She said the research is the first time the intercropping technique was used in space soil. And the fact that it worked really well for one out of the three species was a big find, one that we can now build further research on, Gonçalves added. The crops were grown in simulated Martian regolith, a soil with no organic matter. Created by researchers from the American Space Agency NASA, it is a near-perfect physical and chemical match to real Martian soil. The researchers added useful bacteria and nutrients. They also controlled the gases, temperature, and humidity inside the greenhouse to match conditions expected in a Martian greenhouse. For now, human bases on Mars are only seen in movies. But NASA, for example, is developing ways to send people to Mars in the 2030s. Mars is really far away. A flight now would take about 9 months. If you want to live there as humans, you will have to grow your own crops at the site, said study co-writer Viger Vomelink. He is a plant ecologist at Wageningen and head of BASE, a company that develops lunar and Martian greenhouses. Flying in food is very costly and also vulnerable. Our main goal is to use as much as possible from the resources at the site, he added. Intercropping involves growing plants with properties that could help each other grow. The method makes the best use of resources, including water and nutrients. The researchers said the tomato plants in intercropping may have benefited from being close to the pea plants. That is because the peas are good at turning nitrogen from the air, with the help of bacteria introduced into the soil, into an important nutrient. The carrots produced fewer crops from intercropping, and the peas had no change, Gonçalves said. It is very important how you select the crop species that you combine, because the tomato did profit from the peas, but the carrot most certainly did not. This was probably due to lack of light. The tall tomato and pea plants did outcompete the carrot by taking light from it, Vomelink added.
Plastic music recordings, or vinyl records, are popular again in Brazil. In 2023, more records were sold than compact discs, CDs, and DVDs for the first time in many years. That information comes from Pro Musica, an association of Brazil's largest music production companies. The new interest in the pressed vinyl discs and high-quality but less costly record players is bringing fame to singers who thought they had been forgotten. Katia de França is 77. In the 1970s and 1980s, she traveled through Brazil performing her music, but she was not popular when CDs replaced records. Her music was lost to a new generation who did not use old record players. By 2021, De França was living in a small community in the mountains above Rio de Janeiro. She said, "It was where you can't even imagine an internet signal." But one day, she got a telephone call from the head of a small record company. He said he wanted to make a new version of her first record from 1979, called 20 Words Around the Sun. This must be a prank, De França thought at the time, but it was not. The producer wanted to make more copies of her 40-year-old record.
Today, at 77, De França is again traveling Brazil performing her music for new fans. Her new fame is part of a rising interest in records. Pro Musica research shows that from 2022 to 2023, the money coming from sales of records in Brazil increased from about $1 million to $2.2 million. It is 15 times higher today than in 2019. Carlos Savala is a 66-year-old music producer in Rio de Janeiro. He owns about 60,000 records and pays attention to their value. He said many people buy and sell used records on websites and social media sites like Facebook or at record stores. Brazilians and visitors are looking for samba, bossa nova, tropicalismo, and other popular forms of music. The trend is in more places than Brazil. In the U.S., sales of vinyl records brought in $1.4 billion in 2023. Some say the interest in Taylor Swift brought about a jump in record purchases. Swift's 2022 record, Midnights, was the first big release to have its records sell more than CDs since 1987. Martin Froese reports on music in Brazil. He said today's top-selling records do not come from the most popular artists. They release their songs to digital streaming services. But new music groups and classic singers drive the sales of vinyl records. By 2008, all of Brazil's vinyl record production centers closed because of digital music services. But after records became popular again in Europe and the U.S., João Augusto and his partners decided to buy an old vinyl pressing factory called Polysom. Luciano Barrera is the company's general manager. He said they began producing old records with commercial appeal and demand. Now, the factory helps record companies and independent music artists put their music on vinyl records. After 15 years, Polysom has pressed 1.3 million records, and other companies have reopened factories.
João Noronha started his pressing center in 2019. He and two friends started a business called Tres Selos. They send their customers one newly pressed record a month. "We didn't expect much," Noronha said, "but in the first month of operations, 120 customers paid for the reissue of Sinceramente, a 1982 album by Sergio Sampaio, a Brazilian singer from the 1970s and 80s. A few years later, one of Noronha's partners, Rafael Cortez, saw that De França's record was selling in the used record market for $135. That is when they started working to get permission to re-release her 40-year-old recording. On the first phone call, Cortez said, De França was suspicious. She wanted to know why anyone wanted her old music. I think her mistrust comes from the fact that the industry often pushed her aside, he said. Cortez and music writer Krish Fuscaldo said De França was combative, firm in her ideas, and offbeat. Although she was performing with many of Brazil's most popular artists and gaining listeners, larger record companies like Columbia Records did not spend the money to advertise De França. Fuscaldo has written about the lack of support women received in Brazil's music history. She said part of the reason De França is popular now is that she was suppressed before. She's absolutely brilliant, Isadora Atab, a fan, said at a recent performance. Some of the larger music companies are starting to get interested in vinyl records in Brazil. The Brazilian partner of Universal Music now has a service. It sends customers new pressings of famous Brazilian singers like Gilberto Gil, Chico Buarque, and Maria Bethânia, along with foreign singers like Billie Eilish. I'm Dan Friedell.
And I'm Gena Bennett.
The American Space Agency, NASA, has completed a new experiment that sent data over 226 million kilometers in space. The result marks a major improvement over previous tests that measured data transfers over 31 million kilometers. The method is known as Deep Space Optical Communications, DSOC. The high-speed transfer technology uses lasers to send large data files over very long distances. NASA is looking to the method to improve or upgrade existing communication technology. Traditionally, NASA has depended on radio communications to send data back and forth through space. But this method has a limited bandwidth, meaning at a certain point the system can no longer effectively process data. So the agency is seeking to use the new method to support new technologies and planned trips to the moon and other places. NASA officials say the DSOC system will be able to transfer huge amounts of science data through space. This is especially needed for large data files as well as high-quality images and videos sent from space. The DSOC system is based on laser technology. Laser communications are also known as optical communications. NASA explains that the technology will permit up to 100 times more data to be sent back to Earth than current radio wave systems. Much like fiber optics replacing old telephone lines on Earth as demand for data grows, going from radio communications to laser or optical communications will allow increased data rates throughout the solar system, NASA said in a statement. NASA said the laser system works with signals that exist at near-infrared wavelengths. Data transferred by laser takes the form of bits, the smallest pieces of data a computer can process. These bits are contained within the laser's photons. NASA is testing the DSOC on its Psyche spacecraft. Psyche was launched in October 2023 on its way to observe a mostly metal asteroid. The experiments involved a device aboard Psyche. It was able to send data to and receive data from a telescope in California. The agency estimates it would take about 9 weeks to transmit a complete map of Mars back to Earth with current radio frequency systems. But with a laser-based method, the time would be cut to 9 days. Also, laser communications equipment is smaller and requires less energy. Laser-based communication has already been demonstrated in low Earth orbit and on the Moon. But the research team working on the DSOC project said this is the first time the method has been successfully tested in deep space. Meera Srinivasan is a project leader at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Southern California. She said in a statement the system was able to transfer about 10 minutes of data during an experiment on April 8th. Srinivasan said the result represented an important new milestone for the project. The asteroid Psyche is traveling to is also called Psyche. It is believed to be made mostly of metal. NASA expects the spacecraft to travel about 3.6 million kilometers over 6 years to reach the asteroid. Developers of the system say when Psyche is at its farthest point from our planet, the DSOC system's photons will take about 20 minutes to travel back to Earth. I'm Bryan Lynn.
Bryan Lynn joins me now to talk more about his science report. Thanks for being here, Bryan.
Sure, Dan. Thank you for having me.
This week's report dealt with some experiments NASA is doing to test a new laser communication method for future missions. Why is NASA making this move now to seek a major upgrade of its communications technology?
So this laser-based communication system has been in development for quite some time at NASA, but it wasn't until October of last year that the agency was able to launch its first technology demonstration mission to actually test it. And as far as why now, it really has to do with advances in technology. Methods used in the past worked fine when the data and instruments were based on older technology, but the newer technology and data gathering methods simply demand more bandwidth and faster speeds. So officials say this new system is, at this point, considered a necessity for them.
All right. Thanks again, Bryan, for joining me on the program. And thanks for your report.
You're welcome. Thank you, Dan.
Is Anna Mateo.
My name is Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
Anna loves to be outside, but she is often too busy at work to enjoy the outdoors. So in lesson 29 of the series, she is happy to join her coworker, Marcia, who suggests they try to do some work outside.
Hello. In Washington, D.C., there are many places that bring history to life, but people who live here often do not have time to see them. They are too busy with work, like me. Hi, Marcia.
Hi, Anna. Have a seat.
Thanks. This was a good idea. Working outdoors is nice.
Mm-hmm. It is.
Whew. I am tired. Today was a busy day at work, and I still have work to do.
That's too bad.
How are you these days?
I'm really busy too, Anna. Let's get to work.
There are many ways we can talk about being busy. Notice how Anna uses the preposition with after the adjective busy.
They are too busy with work.
We can say we are busy with work, or busy with our jobs, or busy with a project. But when we describe what we are doing, we simply use the ing ending on the verb.
So we can say, I'm busy with work, or we can say, I'm busy working. Here are some other examples.
I'm busy writing my report.
I'm busy these days getting ready for my exam.
These days, I'm busy applying for jobs.
And with past participles that are followed by prepositions such as tired of or worried about, we can simply follow them with a noun or with the ing form of the verb, which is called a gerund. That's spelled G-E-R-U-N-D.
And the gerund works just like a noun. So we can say, I'm tired of work, or I'm tired of working.
We can say, I'm worried about the cost, or I'm worried about spending that much money.
A bit later in lesson 29, Anna and Marcia talk about childhood dreams. They talk about what, when they were children, they hoped to become in the future as adults. Let's listen.
In fact, I wanted to be, don't laugh, President of the United States. Stop! I know, it's a silly childhood dream.
I'm sorry. It's not silly. Guess what I wanted to be?
What?
When I was a kid, I studied the stars and planets. I wanted to fly into outer space.
You know, Marcia, childhood dreams are important.
They are, and it's good to remember them.
The word dream can be a noun or a verb. And when it's a verb, it can be followed by two different prepositions.
We use dream of to express what we wanted to become when we were young. And we use the ing gerund after the preposition of. So Anna dreamed of becoming president, and Marcia dreamed of becoming an astronaut.
The other preposition after the verb dream is about. We use about to express a particular subject of our dreams.
For example, I can say, last night I dreamed about Jill's dog.
I hope she was a good girl in your dream.
She was.
When we want to express dreams for our future, we tend to use the preposition about followed by a gerund. For example, we can say,
oh, I dream about going to Paris one day.
Oh, me too, Andrew. Or we could say, we dream about finding a new home for our family. We can also use dreamed about in the same way as dreamed of to talk about childhood hopes.
So, Jill, did you dream about becoming or doing anything in particular when you were young?
I wanted to be an astronaut, too. I cut out all the stories in the paper about the space program, and I watched live as the first humans walked on the moon. But then I found out you had to be a man and in the military, two things I didn't think were possible at the time.
Well, some of those things have changed.
Yeah. And now there are women astronauts who are not necessarily in the military. Andrew, how about you? What were your dreams?
I don't think I had any very specific dreams of what I wanted to be. But maybe for a few months, I dreamed about becoming a professional tennis player. But I think I dreamed more about interesting places to travel. And now that I think about it, I did dream of going to the highest mountain in the world, to Mount Everest. But I do agree with Anna when she says,
you know, Marcia, childhood dreams are important.
And the dreams we have as adults are important as well. You can tell us about what you dreamed of doing when you were a child, or about your dreams as an adult, by writing to us at learningenglish@voanews.com or putting your comments under this video on YouTube.
And if you want another way to practice your English, just do an internet search of songs with the word dream in the title. You will probably find more songs than you could ever listen to.
That's because most of those songs are about love.
And that's a topic for another day. For now, we hope you've enjoyed today's lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast.
And you can learn more on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. You can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Thanks for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.